The Agar the Swallow is a book, it's a sequel in a small series of two, where some of the characters are repeating and some new characters. And the main protagonist, she's called Marie, and she's a new character. We meet her when she's just finishing her master's thesis, and she finds herself in a little bit of a difficult situation, which doesn't become less difficult when her supervisor is committing suicide. And then she doesn't believe that it's really true that he has committed suicide, and then the book sort of takes off from there. But it's a novel about family matters and about science and about secrets and whether they should be hidden or exposed. And yes, it's a book about many things, which life also is, like many layers at the same time. So The Agar the Swallow is set on campus, like in immunology department, which is something I just made up because immunology apartment is actually not a part of biology, but I made it up for the book. And Marie is a biology student because I also was a biology student myself. So I know this area and I know this milieu very much, you know, how they fight over the money and how there's always these scandals. I actually realized it's much more dramatic than you think of a science environment. I don't think that I could ever have written these books without being a biologist myself, because I really do a lot of research. In Denmark, it's a little bit shorter in France, but in Denmark, there were 5 years between the two novels. And people always ask, oh, why do you have to take so long? And it's because I actually spent at least 2 years on doing the scientific research. And imagine if I was not a biologist, I would have to use even more. In The Agar the Swallow, I call the research group Belém, which is named after one of these quarters in Bissau where they are doing their research, or where it started out. In real life, this quarter is called Bandim, and that's also the name of the research group. And if I should say, like, very in a few words what it is that they are standing for, it's about 20-25 years ago, they discovered something they call unspecific effects. So it's effects of vaccinations that they are not intended. You know, one thing is to want to vaccinate a child with a vaccine against a certain disease, but all the things that are unspecific, you can't really tell why it's working like this or not. And they found out that there's positive unspecific effects and negative unspecific effects. And of course, the positive effects of unspecific effects, they are very welcome because they just make the vaccine even better. You know, it's not only protecting the child against whatever disease the vaccination is designed to protect against, it's also boosting the immune defense system so that the child gets an overall better chance of surviving. So these positive effects are very welcome, but the negative effects are also there, and these are of course not very welcome, because now when the child is vaccinated, it's protected against the disease that it's supposed to be protected from, but the immune defense system is somehow suffering, and now the child has a larger chance to die of diseases that it wouldn't have probably died of if it was not vaccinated. And this is, of course, has to be looked into and has to be accepted from the powerful authorities so that it can be found out how to exploit the good unspecific effects and get rid of the negative ones. The funny thing is, when I started to work together with Bandim, of course, they approached me because they were being so tired and frustrated of always having trouble getting across to the public. So this was a little crazy idea the doctor got, and then it developed from there. And I actually always thought that it would have a bigger impact when the novel came out than it actually had. And they always said, just wait and see, no one will react, because that's the experience that they have made. And of course, lots of people reacted on the novel as a piece of entertainment or a piece of literature, but very few people actually realized it's based on true science. And no, there was one journalist in Denmark who picked up on this and actually tried to unfold it, which I was very surprised about, and I thought it was a very big shame. Here in France, it's the first country where it's actually like really telling the reader straight away what to be observant about. I'm of course a little bit sad or disappointed that it has not moved more mountains scientifically, because I was really hoping to help them, you know. And of course I'm also a little bit personally scandalized by the fact that it's such important topic, it's such many children dying, it's such scandal in a way, and it just happens without anyone really making notice of it. Of course, I'm always, when I'm writing, trying to make some points which I've also made in my own life. And being a daughter of a feminist generation, born in the 70s, and growing up with a mother who had to fight a lot to her right to work, to her right to be equal with men, I'm of course a product of that kind of upbringing. And I thought it's quite nice. I was also alone with my daughter for a while, and I often had the feeling when I met men, they were like seeing my daughter as a little bit of a problem. So I thought it would be really nice to write a portrait of Søren, and why he's such a wonderful stepfather, but Anna is also kind of seeing it as I'm giving Søren a present, you know? It's my wonderful daughter, and he gets to be with her more than half the time. It's out of my kindness. And then while my daughter and my partner are having a good time, I will work.